Greetings today in the name of Jesus Christ, our wonderful Lord and Savior, on this beautiful Lord's Day and also Mother's Day. We welcome every one of you here in the auditorium. We have several visitors. We're just delighted to have you. And you that's listening out in the radio listening audience, most certainly appreciate you tuning in to Northside Baptist Church Hour that's coming to you live right from the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church here in Athens, Georgia. Now, this is Preacher Edward speaking. We're hoping the hour coming up we can be a real inspiration to everyone. And I hope we have quite a few good mothers out in the radio listening audience that can't be in church today, be tuned in and get this good hour coming up. So we welcome every one of you. May the good Lord bless you. And at the close of the service today, we're going to recognize our mothers. We have quite a few here. And so we appreciate their presence. I want you to take your Bible and turn, will you please, the book of Ruth, chapter 1, page 315 in the original Scofield Reference Bible. Ruth, chapter 1, page 315. Remember, you can get this tape by writing in to Post Office Box 501, Athens, Georgia, 30603. Zip code number, just address your mail to Virgil Edwards, the Preacher Edwards. Enclose a gift for $3 or more to defray, help defray our radio expense. We'll get the tape right in the mail to you. All right, we're going to bring a message on this line of thought, a mother's choice. We find in the land of Judea, many, many years ago, there's a great famine, time of hardships, and there was no real king in those days, and every man did that which was right in his own eyes. And they did what they wanted to do until they came to the place they didn't want to do what they did do. And then here comes on the scene the beautiful little book of Ruth, one of the greatest love stories embedded in the Word of God. And we find a great mother. In fact, we find more than one mother here, but in particular, we want to mention Ruth. Ruth is one of the greatest mothers in history. She was the mother of Obed, the grandmother of Jesse, the great-grandmother of King David, and the direct ancestress of Jesus Christ. It was a choice which Ruth made that made her such a great woman and mother. There comes a time when a mother has to make a choice. I mean a real serious one. A choice that involves a lot of things, maybe that a father or others wouldn't think about. There's never been a time in the history of mankind whenever mothers have to make such choices as they do to children. We're living in perilous times and momentous days and days of evil when crime is filling the land. And mothers have to make these choices many times, unpopular choices, choices maybe their children don't understand, and oftentimes maybe a choice even their husband wouldn't understand. And we find that this lady here, Ruth, made a choice that absolutely changed her entire life and brought her into history and embedded in the Word of God. And one of the most beautiful love stories you find in the Bible. And Ruth is one of the most beautiful names that you can imagine for a woman today. And of course, it means a friend. The name Ruth means a friend. Now, I want you to notice, first of all, that Ruth chose God. It's a great day when any mother chooses God. Been many of a family led to heaven, many of a husband won to God because mother chose God. And you're wise as a mother, whether you be young or old, when you choose God as your Savior. Now this mother did that. Ruth chose God. She lived down in the land of Moab, came from a cursed family, and she lost her husband. And time had come for her mother-in-law to go back to the land of Judea and to Bethlehem. As she told Orpah and Ruth, the two women that had married her sons had died, "You stay here in the land of Moab and worship your gods among your people." And Ruth said, "I'm not going to remain here. I'm going back with Naomi." She had to make up her mind to say goodbye to the Moabitish people, to say goodbye to her parents and her friends and her country, and to pay that price of leaving them, maybe never to see them again, and go with Naomi back to Bethlehem, Judea. And she made that wonderful choice. I thank God for my own precious mother. My mother, bless her heart, had her arms around my neck. and tears falling on my face of her eyes when I said an eternal yes to God in 1940. My mother loved God and stood by me faithfully. Nobody ever stood by me closer than my precious mother doing my ministry. She backed me up 100%. When she could not travel, when she's invalid because of a problem she had, I'd go see her and she'd say, "Now, son, I can't go. I can't do what I'd like to do for the Lord. But, son, you can. I want you to pray for me. I'm going to pray for her," rather, she'd tell me. "I'm going to pray for you, son, because you can go and I can't." Oftentimes, I'd go in to cheer her up, but I'd leave being cheered up myself. She'd clap her hands together and say, "Son, don't worry about me. I'm all right. This world is not my home. I'm just a passing through. You get out that gospel." Many times she said, "Son, you get out that gospel. You preach that gospel. By the help and grace of Almighty God, I intend to preach the gospel as long as God lets me live upon the earth." My precious mother said, "Son, preach that gospel. I can't go and do it like you can. God didn't call me to do that, but I'll certainly pray for you as you go." And she's in heaven rejoicing today. And oh, how I'd like to see her. One of these days I will see her by the grace of God. I'm looking forward to that time. And this woman, Ruth, beautiful young woman, Moabitess girl, living in a cursed land, made her choice. In verse 16, she said, "Thy God should be my God." But let me read these a couple of verses here because they're so blessed. In Ruth chapter 1, beginning with verse 16, "And Ruth said, Entreat me not to leave thee or return from following after thee. For where thou goest, I will go. Where thou lodgest, I will lodge. Thy people should be my people, and thy God should be my God. Where thou diest will I die, and there will I be buried. Lord, do so to me and more also, if aught but depart from thee and me." And so we find these beautiful words spoken by Ruth. In verse 18, "When she saw she was steadfast in mind to go with her, then she left speaking unto her." Here's a young woman that made her choice, and she made her choice in the right direction. She made her choice for God. She left the false gods of the Moabitess people and chose the true God of the Hebrews. No mother can be truly great if she leaves God out of her life. Now this meant to give up all the old religious traditions of the past that she learned among her people. She grew up in a land of idolatry where they worship false gods, where they sacrifice their own children to a false god. And she grew up in that atmosphere. But she chose a prayer answering God, one that could hear her prayers, one that could answer her prayers, one that could be satisfied with what she did on the earth. Any mother is wise, whether young or old, when they choose God number one in their life. So many things will fall in order, and so much is accomplished. Great statesmen, great men have come along and gone to the White House and in the political fields to serve God in their country because they had a great mother that spent time on her knees. Many of the great preachers graced the pulpit in their churches and various other places because there was a great mother there praying for them. Great mothers have spent time on their knees in the Word of God, reading God's book, praying for their children. I think about the mother of Charles and John Wesley, how their mother spent hours on her knees, praying for those two boys and the remainder of her family. She had some 19 children, and there she prayed for them, and she saw two of them go into the ministry to serve God faithfully. Thank God for praying mothers to make the right choice. Number two, Ruth chose the path of the godly. She chose to live the life of the righteous. Now you cannot walk the straight and narrow way without God. Now she said, "I'm going down the path of the godly. I'm going to choose the path of the godly." Godly women and ungodly women don't go down the same path. They're not going down the same road. They're headed in different directions. One go the straight and narrow, the other broad and wide way to destruction. And she chose a path of the godly. I'm going to walk with the godly. She said to Naomi, I'm going to walk with the godly. She made a great mother's choice. I'll get God, let God's people be my people. I'll walk with the godly. When you decide that you're going to walk with the godly, you've made a great decision. Anybody can go out here with the drinking crowd, the cursing crowd, the dance floor crowd, the picture show going crowd, and all of that gang. You can go down that road if you please, but you'll be the loser in the end. It takes a real person, a real mother, to stand up and say, I'm going to walk in the path of the godly. Away with the world. Away with worldly pleasure. Away with the things of this life that distract and lead me away from God. I'm going the path of the godly. Number three, Ruth chose the home of the godly. You know, it's wonderful to have a godly home where Christ is. I may be speaking to someone today out there. Maybe you have a large family. Maybe there's a husband or wife sitting there in the living room or there in the kitchen. And you have little children playing around there in the room or out in the yard. And nobody in that family knows God. In other words, Jesus Christ is not in your home. You without God in your home. You don't have Jesus in your home. Unless there's somebody saved in that home, Jesus Christ is not there and he's not welcome. He's never been invited in. And you're going along without him. And how sad. She chose a home of the godly. It's wonderful when you have a home where there's godly people. Where you have a home where mother knows God or dad knows God or some member of the family knows God. I can remember when I was a little boy growing up, just a little fellow. We lived out in the country. I was a country boy, and I'm proud of it. My mother would have wash day once a week. And then when she would finish the washing, she'd say, leave the soapy water, son, in the tub or in the pot. We're going to scour the floors. Back in those days, they called it scouring the floors. Today, they'd call it scrubbing the floors. And they had these old-fashioned mops. You'd put corn shucks in them and fix up the mops in order to scour the floor. I've seen my precious mother go in and sprinkle white sand on the floor. I thought, my, why is she doing that? Is she going to clean the floor? No need to put the white sand on there. She said, son, that helps clean the floor. Then I would go get the soapy water and dash it on the floor. And my mother would take that old mop with those shucks in the end of it. And up and down that floor she would go scouring. And then she'd start singing. On Jordan's stormy banks I stand and cast a wistful eye. She was thinking about that promised land on the other side. My mother didn't know I was enjoying that and appreciated that. I didn't tell her. I didn't say, Mama, I enjoyed you singing today. But I never forgot about it. It was a blessing to my heart. And whenever that floor would dry, it'd be almost snow white. Because my mother spent time cleaning the floor and singing the song. That meant a lot to this little country boy as he grew up. Thank God for the home of the godly. My precious mother didn't have a chance to go to churches today like we have. Live way out in the country, maybe go to August meeting whenever they had a chance, something like that, go on a wagon or buggy or walk, and didn't have the privilege that I've had and you have had as a younger person to be able to meet in God's house on the Lord's Day and sing the praise of God. But I'm glad after time rolled on, God called me to preach, gave me the privilege of organizing some Baptist churches. Many times I've seen my precious mother walk down this aisle praising God. I've seen her come out of the choir praising God. I've seen her walk from one side of this church to the other, waving a handkerchief and praising God and thanking God for salvation. Tears rolling down her cheeks. I'll never forget that. That meant so much to me. I'm so glad that God called me to preach. I'm so glad that God permitted me to build a church where my mother could come and worship God until she left the world or got disabled to come to the house of God. I'm glad about it. I thank God for that privilege. I thank God for other mothers that's come into Northside and other churches have organized and praise God and rejoice because a place to worship God. I thank God that she chose a home of the godly. And number four, we find that she chose her friends of the godly. Now you listen to me today. Some of you young people, you're running with the wrong crowd. You're running with that card playing crowd. You're running with that moving picture show crowd. You're running out there with that worldly crowd, that dancing crowd. You're running with the wrong crowd. And God said, don't go with the crowd to do evil. It's going to cost you. It's going to cost you in the end. May cost your children a lifetime in hell, forever in hell. It may cost you dearly. You're going with the wrong crowd. You're headed down the wrong road. You're leading your family in the wrong direction. Now, she called her friends and chose the friends of God to be her friends. The greatest friends you could ever have are the people of God. I was walking down life's highway one day, and I met a friend. And that friend was Jesus. Then I became acquainted with his friends, the people of God. Greatest people on the face of the earth. She said in verse 16, thy people shall be my people. Isn't that wonderful? Ruth said, thy people shall be my people. When you come to know God, then God's people become your people. Greatest people in all the world, the people that know God. I'd rather be around God's people than any people in the world. They're the greatest. I love them. That's where I like to be. I've said many times, I can hardly wait on Sunday morning for you to get here to the church so I can shake your hand and be with you and fellowship with you. I look forward to it. I really do. I come to the house of God early, long time before service time. Watch the saints as they come in and shake their hands. Enjoy being among God's people. I look forward to it. I'll tell you, the Lord's Day can't come too often for me. If it came every day, that'd suit me the better. I left to meet with God's people in God's house. She chose God's people. Now, you can judge a person's character by the kind of people they run with. If you want to know the kind of person a person is, check the company they associate with. Check the crowd they run with. Check what they do, and you can find what kind of person you're associating with. Old Dr. Bob Jones Sr. said, you can lie down with the dogs, but you certainly get up with fleas on you. Now, you can go out here and lie down with the dogs and run with the dogs if you want to, but when you wind up with fleas on you, blame nobody but yourself. Get with the right crowd. Run with God's people. There's no fellowship between light and darkness. If you're saved, how can you fellowship with this ungodly world? You can't do it. God called you to fellowship with his people and witness to this world. You can have no fellowship with this ungodly world. You're chosen God's people, Christian people. Choose God's friends, your friends, the Christian people. In 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 4, Simon Peter said, wherefore they think it strange that you run not with them the same excessive right, speaking evil of you. Yes, they can't understand you when you start running with God's people. When you go to God's house on the Lord's day with the book of God in your hand, this world can't understand that. They say, I don't see what they get out of that. You know why they say that? They know not your God. They know not the book of God. They know not the Savior. They know not the peace you have in your heart. They know not the Holy Spirit. That's why they can't understand it. So you run with God's people. Choose the friends of God to be your friends. Number 5, Ruth chose the death of the godly. In verse 17, she said, where thou diest, will I die. There will I be buried. She said to Naomi, where you die, Naomi, I'll die. Where God's people die in Bethlehem, Judea, I'll die. She said, I want to die with God's people. I'd much rather die with God's people than to die with the people of this world, hadn't you? I surely had. I'll die with God's people, she said. While thou diest, will I die. And then she said, I'll be buried there. John Wesley said, our people die well. God's people should die well. In Psalms 116, verse 15, he says, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. Oh, it's wonderful to die among God's people and to die among the saints of God. She said, I'll choose the death of the godly. Who wants to die the death of the wicked? Many of a man and woman has died screaming, I'm going to hell. I can feel the fire. The demons are after me and scream as their soul leave their bodies. Who wants to die a death like that? Not me. I've heard people dying and praising God. My own precious mother, she was unconscious for a period of time, maybe a couple of days. She knew nothing. My sister was sitting by her bedside whenever she drew her last breath. My sister said, my mother raised up in the bed. lifted her eyes and looked as though she saw something, and then closed her eyes and went on to heaven. Did she see something? She surely did. I'd rather die a death like that any time than a death of one screaming, I know not God. I'm going down in the pit of darkness. I'm going to hell. I'm burning in this flame. I'll tell you, to die the death of a righteous is precious in the sight of God Almighty. My grandmother, my great-grandmother, when she went on to be with God, she was on her deathbed, and you know what she said just before she died? She said, I see two angels at the foot of my bed. She said, don't you see those angels? They in the room said, no, we don't see a thing. She said, there's two angels at the foot of my bed. You don't see them? No, we don't see them. She closed her eyes. Those angels carried her soul home to be with God. The Bible said when Lazarus died, the angels came and carried him into Abraham's bosom. Oh, I'd rather die the death of righteous. There's a great man here in Athens many years ago. He was a mighty soul winner. He lived for God every day, won souls every day for the Lord Jesus Christ. He is up in years. On his deathbed, he called his wife, said, honey, come here. She came into the room. He said, do you hear what I hear? She said, no, I don't hear anything. He said, listen, you can't hear that? She said, no, I don't hear. He said, I hear some of the most beautiful music I've ever heard in my life. Said, you don't hear it? No, I don't hear it. Oh, listen at that beautiful music. Closed his eyes, went home to be with God. Had you rather die a death like that? Die with the people of God than to go out here and die among the weak and the ungodly. Number 6, Ruth chose the burial place of the godly. Verse 17, and there will I be buried. She said, when I die in Bethlehem, Judea, I want you to bury me there among God's people. I want you to bury me in God's promised land. I want you to bury me there in Bethlehem. She is concerned about where she was to be buried. Now you should be concerned about where you're buried. I don't believe in this matter of burning your bodies and back to ashes when you die. The Bible didn't say go back to ashes. The Bible says go back to dust is where you should go. And I don't believe in the heathen act of burning your body when you die. I think it's wrong. I think you dishonor your body. And you may disagree with me. You may not like it. But to cremate a body, I think, is a sin. And I wouldn't want mine cremated. I want to go back to the dust where God said I would go when that body is placed in the grave. Beloved, I want to be buried with God's people. I want to be buried in a decent cemetery. You should respect these bodies and honor these bodies if you're a child of God, because the Holy Ghost lives in them and God bought you with a price, and that body belongs to God. Don't mistreat that body after you die, allow anybody to do it. It belongs to God. That's God's body. And she said, I'll be buried where they bury God's people. That's why I want to be buried in Bethlehem, Judea. Now Ruth chose the reward of the godly. Number 7. It means far more than the pleasure of this world. She said, I'm going to choose the reward of the godly. Now, Jeshemiah should have stayed there in the Moabitish country, land of Moab, east of the Dead Sea, and lived there among those heathen, and grew up there worshiping those heathen gods, and then died, should have gone to hell. But she didn't remain there. She made a choice. She said, I'm going to choose God. I'm going to serve God. I'm looking forward to the reward of God. The Bible says Moses chose rather to suffer with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasure of sin for a season. And she went back to Bethlehem, Judah. Now you read the rest of the book of Ruth and see how God blessed that woman. How she married a great man. How God gave her a great son. And through that great son came David, and she is ancestors of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. What a reward. What a blessing. To die with the family of God, all because she made that great choice. There's a woman in the Bible among the Gibeonites. Now the Gibeonites had come in and pretended that they had come a long way, and they, of course, got Saul to spare their lives, and Saul spared their lives, but later on, we find that Saul, in order to please some, had put some of them to death. And God sent a plague upon Israel. And it hadn't rained in 3 years. And David sought the face of God and said, "What's the trouble, Lord?" He said, "Because Saul killed the Gibeonites after he made a league with them." And David said, "Well, what can I do to get the curse of God lifted?" The Gibeonites said, "We want 7 sons of Saul. We'll hang them. And when we hang those 7 sons, then the curse will be lifted." And there David gave him 7 sons of Saul, 2 from Rizpah. A woman named Rizpah had 2 sons, took her 2 sons. They went out and they hanged those 7 sons out there on the crosses. And there they let their bodies hang there day in and day out. But the mother of those sons, Rizpah, the mother of 2 of those sons, she went out there where they hanged her sons. And she sat there day and night. Whenever the buzzards came in the daytime, she'd run them away. When the wolves and animals came at night, she'd run them away. She never left. She never left those 2 boys hanging there on those crosses or on the trees or wherever they hanged them. She stayed right there until David found out about it. And when David found out about it, he did something about it. He took those bodies down and gave them a decent burial. But that good mother, she stayed put. She absolutely wouldn't leave. She wouldn't leave the bodies of those sons or stay there day and night from the time until the harvest came and the rains came. And so from one season to another, she never left those boys according to the Bible. Thank God for a mother's love and concern about her children. There's a wayward boy one time left home, and his mother didn't know where he was. She prayed and she wept and she grieved about it. And she started looking for him. One day she came to a place where a great number of people assembled around a big oak tree. She saw they were about ready to hang somebody from a limb of that tree. She stopped her buggy. She got out. She ran across that field. And when she came near that boy, it had the rope around his neck. She recognized that boy to be her boy. She came in and he's hanging from that rope. And she said, "Listen, people, I don't know what he's done. Maybe he deserved this death." She walked up and kissed his blue lips. And she said, "He's my son. And I don't care what he's done. I still love him." I'll tell you, a mother's love means something. It really does. Even in the animal, the fowl world, a mother's love means something. An animal will fight to death for its little ones. So will fowls many times. And thank God for a mother's love toward her children. There's a man had a precious wife, Christian woman. She died. He went out to the cemetery and put up a marker. On this marker, he put Frank Morgan. He put her name Elizabeth Morgan. And then he put Frank Morgan, Elizabeth Morgan, the mother of Mary and John and Paul. He had 3 children. And after the funeral, after the burial, after he put up the monument, he went and got those 3 children. He carried them to that grave. He said, "Boys, you had one of the greatest mothers that ever lived." He said, "Now listen, listen, boys, listen, girl." He said, "Your name's on that grave marker right below your mother's name. And if any one of you ever do anything to bring shame and reproach upon the name of your mother, I'll bring a chisel out here, and I'll chisel your name off this marker, and it'll never be put back there again." Oh, how we ought to respect our mothers, how we ought to appreciate them and stand by. I have a little poem here that I picked up someplace. The author's unknown. And the title of it is, "All Are All the Children In?" I often think as night draws nigh of an old house on the hill, of a yard all wide and worn, while the children play at will. And when night came down, hushing the merry dim, mother would look around and ask, "All the children in?" 'Tis many years since then, and the old house on the hill no long echoes to childish feet, and the yard is still, so still. I see it all as the shadows creep through many of the years have been. Even now I hear mother ask, "All the children in?" I wonder if when the shadows fall on the last short earthly day, and we bid goodbye to this world, all tired with our children's play, and we step in upon the other land where mother so long has been, will we hear her ask of old, "Are all the children in?" I want to say something. When they sang that song, "Will the Family Circle Be Together?" I want you to know, if you have a precious mother in heaven today, she's looking for you. She's expecting you to be there. And if you don't get saved and meet her in heaven, it'll be your fault, not hers. But oh, I should like to ask, are all the children in? Well, you say, yes, I'll be there. Tell mother I'll be there. In answer to a prayer, tell my darling mother I'll be there. Thank God for our mothers. Let's stand to our feet. Father in heaven, today I want to thank you for the precious, precious memories of my darling and precious mother. Thank you, our Father, I never heard a curse or oath in her life. I never saw her drink whiskey. I never saw her out on the dance floor. I never saw her in a moving picture show. Never saw her in any sinful, wicked places. I thank God for these precious memories of my darling mother, who's in heaven, Father, with thee. And yes, I'll see her again someday by your marvelous grace. Thank you for what you meant to me during my ministry and my life upon the earth. Now, Father, we thank God not only for my mother, but for every great mother in this building, not in the radio listening audience. Have your way in this invitation. I pray in Christ's name, amen. Amen. Debbie's going to play for us. And listen to me. If you're here, you're unsaved, and you want to get saved, come down here. We'll help you to God. If you once knew the Lord and you backslid on God, you come down here. We'll help you back to God. If you're here and you want to join this church and we receive members, you may come. If for any other reason that God is speaking to you about coming, you ought to obey God. Now, she's going to play a couple of stanzas. We'll give you ample time to respond to the invitation. And you ought to move. You ought to come if God is speaking to your heart. How about it? Is God speaking? One more stanza. God is speaking. Obey the Lord.